Okay. Hello, everyone. Today, our talk is about closure for Java programmers. I'm Madhuparna from Quintype, and I have been working with closure for the past 3 years, and I'd be giving this presentation with my colleague, Rashmi.
Hi, I'm Rashmi. I'm head of engineering at Quintype Technologies. I have about 20 years of experience doing product development, mostly in object-oriented programming languages like Java, C++, Objective-C, and like most other OOPS programmers, have tried to retrofit other languages like Lua, JavaScript into being OOPS. So that brings us to the intent of this talk. They say a picture speaks 1,000 words. So we have legacy OOPS programmers versus current functional programmers. And what we found is that they're both completely different paradigms. And people find it really hard to go from one to the other. When I started, I joined Quintype about a year back, and that's when I sort of got thrown into closure. And I was actually pretty confident, having sort of worked on so many different languages, that this would just be yet another different language. But I don't think it's exactly that. It's really important to get the paradigm of the language before you sort of jump into sort of coding mechanically. So our intent here is to make it easier for OOPS programmers to adopt closure. So we'll explain the differences and the similarities. More importantly, we'll also try to explain the underlying workings so that it's easier for Java programmers to relate to closure. And as we do this, we are going to refrain from comparing which one is better. That really takes a very different kind of energy. So the topics we'll cover, basically we'll go through the paradigm, object-oriented versus closure, object references in OOPS versus the closure persistent data structures. Closure is hosted on the JVM. So how do you sort of leverage all the functionality that Java has? Java iterators versus seeks in closure, polymorphism, and then mutability in closure. So speaking of paradigm, before I start off with the paradigm, I think it's important for anybody who's gone, sort of learned more than one language to know that every language has a lot of similarities, right? So every language would have variables, if conditions, for loops, a way that you can do input, output, and so on. What differs between languages is the paradigm of the language. And once you've had that, it's sort of easier to adopt the language. So coming to the object-oriented paradigm, again, I think for those of you who have been here long enough to know what existed before object-oriented programming, there were languages like C, etc., which would be basically a whole bunch of functions with thousands of lines of codes, and you have a lot of global variables, functions overwriting global variables, and it was a real mess. And then OOPS came along, and people were sort of all for it. What it allowed you to do was encapsulate data, right? So hide data, and give access to what is required through public methods. And that's basically what OOPS is all about. You go about modeling the real-world entities with classes, and you provide the right contracts with those classes, right? So what we have here is a very simple class, which has a private variable, and it has one public method, add, which takes in a certain int value and adds the y to the x there. So coming to the closure, the functional programming paradigm.
Yeah, so here we mostly give emphasis on the data immutability. What do we understand by immutability, right? Given any data at a specific type period of time, the data shouldn't change. It should remain constant. Yeah, so because we are talking about functional programming, it's all functions, and given any input, you'll get an output, but your functions here need to be pure. And the next point which we can talk about is the code as data, which is based on Lisp. So given any piece of data, right, any function you write that can be provided as another parameter or argument to any other function. And other thing is, as Rashmi was saying, right, your closure, it's built on the JVM. So whatever code you write, everything is going to get compiled into the JVM bytecode. And for giving a slightly better picture, we have an example here where we are defining a namespace called the adder and a function we have written called addInt. Now, as Rashmi was saying, in object orientation, we have classes to access this properties and methods, whereas in closure, we have these namespaces. So until and unless you require these namespaces, you won't be able to access the functions which you have written in it. So this is somehow we have been able to achieve modular data. Yeah.
All right. So like Madhu's talked about namespaces, I think OOPS programmers have a couple fears, right, when they start learning functional programming. So one is that, well, they learn to structure data using classes, and now all of that seems to go away. You have to write a bunch of functions apparently again. So how do I organize my code? Namespaces are the way to organize code in closure. You have to be particularly careful you don't add all your functions to a single namespace. And then the other fear is that, well, I came from a world of functions and methods, and you're putting me back into a world of functions and methods. So I thought this was a very basic thing to put out there, but it's important. And this really drives it home. So I'm sure all of us have seen a function like this when we learned maths. So any function f that takes an input x will always give you y as the output, right? There is no way that given the same input, you would get back a different output. And that's what immutable functions are. That's what Madhu has been talking about, data immutability. And that's what a functional programming tries to stress on. So you try to create pure functions as much as you can. And again, they have no side effects, right? So what is a side effect? Things like a println statement is a side effect. So once you've at least understood the paradigm of the language, you're sort of ready to take on more. So what's next? Object references. They are one of the sort of key concepts for OOPS programmers. I have, again, a very simple example here. We looked at the adder class in the previous slide. What we have here is an instance of the adder class. We call foo with the adder instance, and then we print out the value of my adder, right? So in this case, when the value is printed out, you will find that it has the value after the addition of 10, right? What does that mean? It means that when I passed an adder into foo, it actually got passed in by reference. So what does that imply? It really means that OOPS really requires management of references and hence state change. And a lot of focus is spent on efficient memory management, right? Ensuring that you don't create copies of objects. If anybody here worked on C++, C++ used to have these series of books, Effective C++, More Effective C++, and such, which basically focused on how you ensure you do not create copies of objects when returning objects or passing in as parameters and such. And then, so basically what this all sort of means is that it's really important to follow best practices to control the state change. And you can very quickly go sort of lose control and end up with really messy code. All right. So that brings us to closure.
Yeah. So talking about objects and references, and as Rashmi was saying about the copies, right? So here we don't pass any objects we don't pass any references here, and we are saying our functions need to be immutable, right? And so here, talking about copies. So it feels like when we are passing a data to a function and getting back a data without mutating it, it's mostly like we are creating copies of it and using up the memory. But here in closure, we have something called the persistent data structure. So Yeah. So given any data, Clojure converts it into a binary tree, right? And if when some function works on it or manipulates this data, given this example here, you can see in the last leaf node, we have a tree there, which we are trying to modify. So what happens here is, after the data has been modified, it tries to go and connect to the parent node. So what happens is this tree creates a copy of its parent, and the parent creates a copy of the node, but there are data which have not changed yet, the other nodes and the other leaves. So this brings me to the term called shared memory. So instead of making copies, whatever existing data or the unchanged paths are there, we go and share that data. So we partially copy the data instead of making full copies of it. This is how we get away with the creating copies of the same data and using up the memory.
Right. So yes, Clojure does manage memory effectively, like you saw. That might have been a little simplistic for an example, but the concept is exactly that. All right. So Clojure is implemented using Java. There are no wrappers as such. You can directly leverage Java functionality in Clojure, and that makes it really cool to use, right? So let's see what we have here. We have a very simple example here again, demonstrating how you can use the Java lang string in Clojure. What we're doing here in the first line is creating an instance of string with the parameter test, which has spaces around it, and then calling trim on it, right? The next line actually tests the type of the literal test. And what that tells me is that Java, it's basically a java.lang.string. And what that means is basically Clojure just uses the internal Java lang string for strings in Clojure. And that's because Java lang string also is an immutable object, right? So there are no sort of gimmicks done to make it immutable. hence the next line of code, which is directly calling trim on test, because it is going to instantiate a string internally. That gives me the same result. And then the last one there is just Clojure names nomenclature, calling with the namespace Clojure.string. Again, this is just one example. You can basically invoke any other classes, static functions on classes, or instantiate objects, etc., in Clojure, while maintaining the data immutability. So that's the key aspect of it. So it may seem that you may lose your data immutability. That's not true. So as we go through these slides, you'll find the differences, but you have to keep in mind that the data immutability is maintained. All right, so iterator versus seek. I'm sure anybody here who's worked on Java has used iterators. They allow you to traverse through collections. You have an iterator interface that collections implement.
Yeah. Whereas, in case of collections in Clojure, the interface which it's implemented on is the iSeek. And we have the function called seek, which can be used for, yeah, used to tell that these are all the data structure implementations. Okay, here in the example, you can see that when we are traversing through this collection, which has, you know, multiple types of data structures like the map, the vectors, the list, everything gives me back true, saying that these are all seeks and its interface is the iSeek. The one crucial difference of traversing through the collections in Java and in Clojure is, in Clojure, these are all stateless and they are persistent.
All right. So polymorphism. So every OOPS programmer can rejoice, and so did I within a month of learning Clojure, that yeah, Clojure couldn't do without polymorphism either. So what is polymorphism? Just to brush up on that, it's an ability for an object to have multiple forms or behaviors. And you have two types that generally people use, override or overload. So again, we have an example here in Java, which this is an interface which has two methods, compute, they're both called compute, they just take different parameters, and hence they're basically overloading the compute function. Versus we have a class adder that implements the MyMath interface and provides implementation for the two methods. And then there's a complex adder that extends adder and again implements the both the two functions, the two methods. And that's basically overriding the behavior of the base class. And so that is override, right? So let's look at polymorphism in Clojure and how is it supported?
Yeah, talking about polymorphism here, we need to talk about few methods here, like the def protocol and the def record. So what does def protocol do? When you define a def protocol, it creates an interface for you, right? Yeah, it creates an interface for you where you can initiate n number of methods within it. And now coming to the def record, what the def record does is, using this particular interface, it creates and it implements it and creates a it implements the protocol, right? So in this example, you can see that we created an interface called MyMath, which has a method called compute. Now what we are doing with this interface is, we are taking this interface and implementing it and creating an instance of it, calling the adder, right? Now, what do we do to the compute here? Because earlier we had just initialized it, here we are implementing it. We are saying, okay, this method is supposed to do an addition for me. Now, when I take this implemented adder, which was implemented on the interface, and I create a, I define my adder 1, and I pass it a value 1 when I initialize it, right? And because now it's an, because I've implemented using the adder interface, I have access to the compute method here, right? Now when I pass a variable and I call the compute method, I automatically get the result 3, because here I have implemented the compute to give me an addition. And one important thing here is, the def record, it generates a bytecode for me and gives me the result back.
Great. Right. So just to sort of highlight the same fact, so def protocol also internally creates a Java interface. And like you say, the exactly same sort of logic was achieved using Clojure as you saw with Java. Just keep in mind though that this is all data immutable. The X that goes into the adder, the def record adder, is also immutable. All right, having spoken so much about immutability, we come to mutability in Clojure. Data immutability in Clojure is what makes it so safe for concurrent programming. You don't have to worry about multiple threads overwriting the same data, etc. But you do require some ways to control, to sort of have some sort of shared state management. And Clojure supports a few data types. We'll basically discuss atoms in this talk. So atoms are implemented using the underlying Java atomic variables. I don't know if people have used atomic integers, atomic long, atomic boolean, etc. The way these work is using the machine level compare and swap instruction, right? And how does that work? So what you do is basically you give a function to an atom, a function that is supposed to change the value of the atom. So the initial value, let's say X of the atom, is noted. The function might compute the new value and apply the new value to the atom. It will use CAS and apply the new value only if the current value of the atom is the same as the initial X value of the atom. Let's say a thread came in and changed the value. It would have to do the retry and go through the whole cycle again. All right, so that's atoms in Clojure. That sort of brings us to the conclusion of the talk. I think having sort of worked with so many programming languages, the key is to sort of understand the best practices in any language. And most languages will have certain common set of best practices. So for example, in Java, if you manage to actually make all your data public, for example, right? And there's no point of really modeling your classes and such. You may end up not just with inefficient code, but a lot of state management that you cannot take care of.
Yeah, and while working with Clojure, I came across one thing that to learn Clojure, you need to practice it, and one try not to create, you know, multi-arity functions and stuff. So that just messes up and it just makes debugging more difficult for you. Also, try to keep your functions as small and do like minimum actions instead of having like a huge function doing multiple stuff, and keep it pure. And the other thing is try to pass as minimum arguments or parameters to it. Otherwise, yes, again, you'll get the arity issues, what I was saying. Yeah, that's pretty much it.
All right, yeah. So yeah, keep in mind, try to understand the paradigm, the underlying workings of the language, and you will not find it difficult to pick up that language. All right, thank you.